Hi everyone, so in this video I'm going to solve problem number 1.13 from my stochastic modeling book. That's the second part of lecture number 26 for APM 504 at ASU Arizona State University. So same story as in the previous video, we are again going to look at some queuing system. In this case, we assume that, like before, the server is going to operate at write new, which means that each time you go in service, it's going to take an exponential amount of time with parameter new so that you can leave the system and service is done. Now we are going, so in the previous problem, we just look at person number n and we don't care about what's before. And we assume that most people can get impatient and leave the system. Here we are going to assume that all of these people, they are going to wait until their turn and go through the system. But then we have new arrivals at write alpha. So that means again that you can think of this process as basically two Poisson processes, one with parameter mu, one with parameter alpha, and each time the Poisson process with parameter mu jumps, then you have one less person in the system. Each time the Poisson process with parameter alpha jumps, then you have one more person in the system. And okay, so that's basically the idea. And there are two questions in this problem. One is about the expected value, and the other one is about more precisely the probability mass function of some random variable x that will keep track of the number of people in the system at the time person n leaves. So that's what we are going to study. We want to understand this random variable x defined as number of people in system when person n leaves the system, or just leaves, okay? So, to understand this random variable, same story as in the previous problem, and in general, that's what you have to do when you look at queuing systems. You need to look at what are the next possible things that can happen in the system. So the system looks like that at some time. Now what can happen at the next update? Well, in this case, that's not too difficult. There are only two possibilities. Either person one leaves, and so you have one less person in the system, or a new person arrives, in which case you have one more person in the system, and that's what we want to keep track of. So basically, and this is going to depend again on whether the arrival times of the Poisson process with parameter alpha are larger or smaller than the one with parameter mu. So here what we want to do is introduce random variables that basically keep track of the time it takes until a new arrival or a departure. And so let's say, for instance, that y is equal to the exponential random variable with parameter alpha that describes arrivals. And then let's introduce also z, which is exponential, but this time with parameter mu. And this one describes the time to the next departure. And we also assume that those two ones are independent. And so basically, what we are going to have in the system is, let's say, number of people in the system is going to evolve as follows. So that can jump by one, or one going up, one going down, plus one if the next thing happening is an arrival, which means y is less than z. So that's with probability, the probability that y is less than z. And this quantity, according to, the superposition property, now we only have two random variables, that's going to be the parameter of y, which is mu, divided by divided by the sum of the parameter, it's alpha plus mu. So this is alpha divided by alpha plus mu by the superposition property. Okay? At the opposite, you have one less person in the system with probability, well, the probability of the complement of this event, so that's y larger than z, and this happens with probability mu divided by alpha plus mu. Okay, so to simplify the notation for after, I'm going to call this one p and this one q, and you see that p plus q is equal to 1. So that's what happens in this system. I'm going to erase that, we don't need this anymore. So next step is from this, we want to find the expected value of x. So what is the expected value of x? Well, for that, you just need to observe that the number of people people who are going to arrive in the system before this person leaves, so let's say number of arrivals before person one leaves, this by definition, so what is that? You are going to wait for an exponential amount of time with formula alpha plus mu, at which time with probability p, you are going to have a new arrival, or with probability q, person one leaves, and that means that the number of new arrivals is going to be zero. So in general, what you have to do is you, at each time step, and again, you can use the memoryless property of the exponential random variable, that's something we use kind of implicitly. It's the fact that, let's assume that first we have someone coming, so we have at some random time you have one more person in the system, so n plus one people, before person one leaves, after you can again restart this argument and say, well, again, at the next update, you are going to have one more person again arriving at with probability p and so on. So basically what we are looking at, if we call in fact this event, let's say s for success, this one for failure, okay, we have some kind of something that looks like the geometric random variable, where the number of new arrivals before person one leaves is going to be, well, that's going to happen with success probability p, and then the number of new people is just equal to the number of tries until we see the first departure of person one. So this means that the number of new arrivals before person one leaves is just a geometric random variable with parameter q. So, in fact, that's not exactly this. This geometric with parameter q is just going to be the number of updates before person one leaves. The last update is going to be person one leaving. The previous ones are going to be person coming in the system, which means that the number of arrivals before person one leaves is, in fact, the time you have the number of updates you need to wait until this person leaves, minus one, okay? So eventually we get this. So this means that in fact the number of arrivals before person one leaves is just a shifted geometric random variable with parameter q. Now, you can use again this restart argument after person one leaves and say, well, no matter how many people you have in the system, the number of ones, you know, starting from the time person one leaves, the number of new arrivals before person two leaves, and person two is this one, it's again going to be a geometric random variable with parameter q minus one, so shifted geometric random variable, which means that your expected value of x is just equal to n times, so that's going to be proportional to n times the expected number of individuals who arrives in the system between two consecutive departures. And we saw that it's geometric q minus one, so this means that your expected value here is equal to n times expected value of geometric, it's 1 over q. You have this minus 1, and so that gives you the answer. So you can simplify this a little bit. Maybe let me write this somewhere else. So eventually, I want to remind you that p, let me write this here, we have plus 1 person in the system with probability p, and p is going to be alpha divided by alpha plus mu. You have one less person in the system with probability q, which is 1 minus p, so that's mu divided by alpha plus mu. And then you can simplify this a little bit. That's or at least write, you can rewrite this explicitly without using this parameter q introduced, but using those like n, alpha, mu that were introduced in the prime. And you get that, so 1 over q is equal to alpha plus mu over mu, so it's n times alpha plus mu over mu minus 1, okay? And this simplifies, it's just n times alpha over mu, so n alpha over mu. So you see that depends on basically this ratio here, alpha over mu. If alpha is large, that's bigger, indeed, more people coming, so x tends to be bigger. At the opposite, mu large contributes to decrease x, that also makes sense. And the whole thing is proportional also to n, because you have to wait for n people, and each time you can restart again the argument, restart the process. And so that makes sense that the answer is proportional to x. So now next question, we want to do something a little bit more tricky. We want to compute really the probability mass function of x. And you will see that the expression of the probability mass function of x is not very nice. And in fact, that's pretty difficult to find the expected value of x from its probability mass function. So in fact, the reasoning we used here is kind of neat. We could hardly deduce this question from the second question about the probability mass function. So, now what is the probability mass function of x? Well, we want to find basically the probability that x equals k for all possible values of k. So k can be zero. It's possible that when person n leaves the system, there was no new arrival, so k can be zero. And can be any non-negative integer, basically. So, how do we compute this? Again, that's a trick using not the geometric random variable this time, but a variation of that. again, if you call this plus one a success, each time you have one more individual a success, and each time someone leaves, you call that a failure. I introduce both this terminology to have a connection with the geometric random variable. You see that basically what we want to keep track of, basically x is equal to the number of arrivals before the nth departure. So that's number of successes before the nth departure. Okay, I'm going to write this. X is equal to number of successes before the nth failure. So that looks a little bit like the geometric random variable with this terminology, except that the geometric random variable would be number of failures before the first success plus one. Okay, that would be the position of the first success. So that's kind of related to that. So now what we want to do is find the probability mass function of such a random variable. And that's not very difficult to do. Basically, that's based on a little picture. I'm going to do it here. I'm again out of space. What does it mean that x equals k? That means that you had k successes before the nth failure. So that means that in the first N plus K outcomes, you should have exactly N failures and K successes. So I'm going to say, to just say that, just again think of, and then we go up to N plus K, we think of the poem as a discrete time process, even if in fact it evolves in continuous time. We don't really care about the time between the updates in this case, because we just want to compute probabilities. And and this means what happens at the first update, what happens at the second update, and so on. So now we know that, so that we have k successes before the nth failure. That means that in this picture, this should be a failure. Okay, that's the number n failure. And then here, in this interval, where you have n plus k minus 1 updates, you want to have exactly k successes. So I'm going to write ks and n minus 1 failures. Okay, so I'm doing this feature to count the number of outcomes in this event. What does it mean that x equals k? Well, that means exactly that in the first n plus k minus 1 updates of this process, we are going to see k success slash arrivals, n minus k failures slash departure, and then we are going to see a failure at the end. So now from that, we can compute the probability that x equals k, or at least first the number of outcomes in this event. Well, the number of outcomes here is just the number of ways you can choose k of those positions out of n plus k minus 1 to position your successes. So that's going to be equal to n plus k minus 1 choose k. And then you see that, good news, that's a technique that we used a lot to compute those probabilities. We have that number of outcomes, and all the outcomes, it doesn't matter how you position your successes, all the outcomes, they have the same probability, okay? Regardless of the order of the successes and failures in this interval, each time, because you have a success with probability P and a failure with probability Q, you should multiply the number of outcomes by their common probability, which is P at the power, so probability of success at the power k, that's the number of successes we want, times probability of a failure at the power n, because we have n failures total. And then that tells you, now I don't need this picture anymore, this tells you that the probability mass function, so now you have a complete expression of the probability mass function. The last thing we can do is just, like for the previous question, again, replace p by its value. Okay, p and q are parameters that we introduce to simplify the notation, but they are not given in the poem. What's given is n alpha mu, and then you can just replace p by its value here, q by its value, and you get a full expression of the probability mass function. So in this case, you are going to get n plus k minus 1 choose k, then times alpha over alpha plus mu at the power k, we said, and then times mu divided by alpha plus mu at the power n. And we don't need this anymore. Now we have the complete expression. Okay, so maybe a few remarks. So even if we answer all the questions, I want to point out one thing. Maybe I can also erase this and just write just the result. So you see that the expression of the expected value is pretty simple. Okay, that's n alpha over mu, and that's it. You understand that trying to find the expected value of x from the expression of its body mass function is pretty intense, okay? You would have to find, well, what is the infinite sum for k equals 0 to infinity of k times this combination times this product here. And that doesn't look nice. That really doesn't look nice. But then the theory tells you that, because we were able to find the expected value of x using other techniques, that this infinite sum is in fact just equal to n times alpha over mu. So that's it. And the other thing I wanted to point out is, again, you see the similarities with the previous problem. In fact, the problem we did before with the people who can leave the line looks very different, but still you start from the same type of system that we call a queuing system. And you see that each time the technique was to really think of what can happen at the next update of the system, and that gives you a range of outcomes. And then you really want to know what is the probability of each of those outcomes. And answering this question allows you to really compute all kinds of probabilities about those systems. And the reason why this works well is because you can only look at the next outcome. And once you arrive at the time of this outcome and you have this update, then you can again restart the system and forget about the past and start again and basically use the same argument as you did before. And it's again due to the memoryless property of the exponential random variable. For instance, if the first thing happening in the system is someone is coming, then you suddenly have n plus one people, then how long does it you still have to wait after that time for person one to leave? Well, it's still exponential with parameter mu. Even if it's already a certain amount of time person one was in service, the remaining amount of time is again exponential with parameter mu because the exponential random variable is memoryless. If those arrival and departure times were not exponential, that would be a nightmare. You would have to condition on what is the probability of this, but given that it's already larger than something, and that would be extremely difficult to compute. What we didn't do in this problem, but we did in the previous one, because in the previous one there was a question about the expected amount of time. It's in this one, because it's only about probabilities and expected value of a number of something, we don't really need to keep track of the time at which the updates occur. But here, if there was a question about that, let's say, for instance, how long do we need to wait until person N goes into the server, then you would have to also keep track of those times. And in this case, it's pretty simple. It just tells you that at each, no matter the state of the system, the time you have to wait until the next update is just going to be the minimum of an exponential random variable with parameter alpha and an exponential random variable with parameter mu. And so the answer is, in average, you have to wait 1 divided by alpha plus mu for the next thing to happen. Okay, again, we didn't use that in this problem, but that's something you want to keep in mind if, for instance, we look at other types of problems. And I think that's it for this problem. We have just one more to go to finish this lecture on number 26.